On the eve of Anzac Day, there's a growing focus on the physical and mental toll on Australian troops in Afghanistan, with particular attention on the issue of post-traumatic stress disorder, or PTSD. After Julia Gillard's announcement of bringing our troops home by 2014, many believe we should prepare for a surge in the number of PTSD cases amongst the returning soldiers. So what can we expect? Nick Lazaridis is in the United States, where it's been reported that a military veteran commits suicide every 80 minutes. Here's Nick with the story.
In almost 12 years at war, America has only been able to sustain its prolonged engagements in Iraq and Afghanistan by sending its soldiers into combat again and again. Already, some of its soldiers have notched up more than a dozen tours of duty.
Such intensive recycling of combat troops is unprecedented in modern warfare, and the extent of psychological stress triggered by it is only now beginning to emerge.
As the world ushered in 2012, one soldier's final journey provided an insight into how that stress has taken hold. On a winding mountain road in America's Northwest, Benjamin Barnes was on a collision course with trouble.
He clearly, by this time, knew that they wanted him to stop, and he wasn't stopping.
The 24-year-old Iraq War veteran was deeply disturbed, and he was armed. Park rangers simply wanted Barnes to stop and fit chains to his tyres, but he kept driving past the checkpoints. What they didn't know was that the former army private had just shot and wounded four people in a fit of rage at a New Year's Eve party in Seattle just hours before.
He got out of the car with a rifle and he opened fire on the ranger behind him. He didn't even have a chance to get out of his car. Boom, 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 boom.
Mountaineers calling. Did a felony stop, shots fired. Officer down at the Longmire entrance to the park.
Park ranger shot and killed at Mount Rainier in a New Year's Day tragedy.
Having shot and killed park ranger Margaret Anderson in her vehicle, Barnes fled into the wilderness as SWAT teams were dispatched to hunt him down.
Pierce County is very concerned about him being a danger, though, with weapons experience and AR-15 ability. They want to stress to anyone that they should not contact Barnes at all.
For Ranger Kevin Barker, it felt like the war was being brought home.
To try to impose another agenda, a violent agenda, on this place of peace was both especially ironic and especially a violation.
What Benjamin Barnes' agenda was, we'll never know. The next morning, police found his body in the icy creek where he'd drowned. But his behaviour has led many experts to point the finger of blame at post-traumatic stress disorder, or PTSD.
Throughout the United States, reports of violence and self-harm by veterans are skyrocketing, and the figures are startling. More than 6,500 suicides a year. That's more than the number of US troops killed in Iraq and Afghanistan combined.
We are betraying the trust of these men and women and their families, and these people were not doing a damn thing about it.
Mark Russell is a former Navy psychologist and an expert on PTSD who turned whistleblower on the US military.
I heard the same rhetoric, what changes are going to come, and I heard the same rhetoric and public testimony in the media and to Congress from military medical officials that were denying there was a crisis. It was, all that was false. It was completely a bold-faced lie.
In mid-March, the war came home to California's agricultural heartland. The small community of Gilroy is still grappling with the devastating impact wrought by a soldier left scarred by war.
It's not easy, you know, to lose a friend. She was just a fabulous person.
Tony Cano is grieving for one of her closest friends, Martha Gutierrez.
I missed her a lot. She was so, such a precious person. And she cares so much.
As an undocumented migrant, Martha Gutierrez had a tough life. But Tony says when Martha's son Abel, an Iraq war veteran, returned home and moved in with his mother and 11-year-old sister Lucero, things took a turn for the worse.
He had changed. He had changed. Things were not okay.
Martha told Tony that her son was abusing her both verbally and physically. And although she feared him, she was reluctant to report his behavior to police.
Yes, these are the names and telephone numbers of some of the people we called looking to find out who Abel was and why he did what he did.
He would sit in his car outside of his apartment and pretend to have a revolver in his hand. Not a real gun, just a pretend weapon. And he would spin the revolver like one does in Russian roulette, point it at his head and pull the trigger.
Newspaper columnist Joe Rodriguez says although residents in the apartment complex were themselves fearful of Abel Gutierrez, they too kept silent.
How do you know when it's time to bring in a guy who doesn't want treatment, but you know that if you don't lock him up against his will, he could either kill himself or kill somebody else?
As Abel's behavior worsened, Martha Gutierrez asked a local veterans advocate, James Brown, to talk to her son.
You know, because I would tell him his mom really cares, and you know, she wanted me to talk to you so that we could try to get you some help. And he would use a lot of profanity and referring to her. And I felt like there was a lot of hatred towards her. And if not hatred, maybe just outrage and at the world in general. And she was an easy target.
But James Brown's efforts to get Abel to seek help were rejected. Desperate for intervention, his mother Martha finally called the police, but they decided that nothing was amiss and that Abel presented no danger.
I'm not really sure what happened in this case regarding the identification of PTSD. However, I can verify that at the time, the family only suspected that he had the disorder. That at no time did the Abel or the family indicate that they were in fear for their life or anybody else's safety, and that's why a mental hold was not placed.
It was a fateful decision. Just days later, after a frantic call from a relative, police returned to the family's apartment and a shocking discovery.
Officers responded and located Abel Gutierrez, deceased, along with an 11-year-old female.
Abel Gutierrez had shot his mother in the car and hid her body on a lonely country lane. Returning to the apartment, he waited another 24 hours before shooting his sister Lucero in the head and then turning the gun on himself.
Gilroy is a conservative, patriotic town. They did see Abel as, first and foremost, an American citizen and soldier who went off and did his duty.
The Gilroy community raised almost $20,000 to bury the family together, regarding all three as victims of the war. Soon after the US invasion of Iraq, Navy Commander Mark Russell was deployed to Spain to set up a Ford neuropsychiatry unit in a military field hospital.
The medical officer looked at me and says, you know, I don't even know why you're here. I said, well, sir, respectfully, I'm here because we're going to go to war, and lessons have shown that people come back from war, they have physical wounds, they have... He goes, I know that, but I really don't know why you're here.
Working out of a rusting shipping container, Russell treated more than 1,500 soldiers suffering severe mental impacts from the trauma of war.
Come on, come on, come on! Come on!
We had folks that came who were had, we call classic conversion hysteria. They had some postures where they were kind of immobilized and fixed in a state, and they couldn't pull a trigger anymore because their hand was paralyzed or something. So we saw folks that exhibited these strange, medically unexplained phenomena.
Russell knew that the military was facing an epidemic of stress disorders and traumatic brain injuries.
I was sending them the information, and they knew we weren't doing PTSD training and treatment training, and we didn't have enough staff. We were bleeding mental health staff. And the demand was this big, and we had this much resources to treat it.
Fed up with the deceit, Mark Russell delivered a paper at an international conference on military medicine entitled Broken Promises, The Untold Story of Military Mental Health. It would ultimately cost him his career.
I certainly got a lot of messages from folks that they didn't want me to keep talking about the problems in the military, mental health care, and that
they heard back from people, did you?
Yeah, oh yeah, frequently. But I just couldn't keep silent. I felt like if I kept silent, I was complicit.
I'm not surprised with the number of suicides our armed forces have witnessed in recent years. Honestly, I'm more surprised the numbers aren't higher.
Now, the issue of the mental health of veterans has caught the attention of the U.S. Senate.
Service members should never have their mental health conditions minimized by a provider, whether it's in the context of care or in a disability evaluation. I'd like to ask the top Army leaders who are here today, how do we put a stop to that?
Democrat Senator Patty Murray has begun probing into what some regard as the U.S. military's most shameful secret, a hidden epidemic that its generals aren't keen to discuss.
General, I think you are very well-intentioned. I know you care as deeply about the soldiers as I do. I'm deeply concerned, just as an American, that someone who served my country has an issue that we owe them as a country to care for them, is told you don't have that condition. And they're sent out either back to the service or sent out into a community with an illness that is not being treated, and they're told they're lying. And that is a problem.
With U.S. troops now being killed by the very Afghan Army soldiers they are helping to train, James Brown believes the mental strain has only intensified.
The guys in Afghanistan right now have to wonder if the people within their own base are their friends or not. That is a 24/7, 365 heightened level of stress and heightened level of distrust of everybody around you at all times. How could that not impact you?
At Moffett Field Air Base in California, I've been invited by James Brown to a private forum attended by soldiers still on active duty to discuss the mental effects of the war.
I just want to get belief. I'm very uncomfortable sitting here talking about it. Because it's hard to talk about something you don't even really understand yourself. Over there, it's 100 miles an hour all the time, you know. You have a purpose, you have something to do over there. You come back and you're standing in line at the grocery store and it's a snail's pace and you just want to freak out because people aren't moving at the pace how you feel. I don't want to die over there. It's just, I don't know, it's an honorable thing for a soldier to die in combat, and I didn't feel like I related to people here.
Is this sense that the invisible wounds are not genuine suffering, they're not real suffering? You know, you don't get a Purple Heart for TBI, don't get a Purple Heart, for PTSD. It's not really suffering, it's a mental thing.
They're pushed to the brink, and they don't care. They use them and spit them out. That's what they did to Jared.
When Jared Hageman returned home after his second deployment to Iraq, his wife Ashley knew that something was terribly wrong.
His whole demeanor would change. It was almost like he was just full of hatred and anger, and his voice would change, and his face, it was almost like he was possessed with just pure hate, and it was scary.
Yeah, I thought so.
After several tours of duty in Iraq, Jared was sent to Afghanistan, but his fragile mental state deteriorated, and he returned home bitter and detached. Drinking heavily, his outbursts became more violent. And when her pleas for help from the local military base went unanswered, Ashley decided to call the police.
I told him, you know, I don't like calling the police. You know, I'm not doing it because I'm mad at you. I'm not doing it to punish you. I'm doing it to force someone to look at us, to, you know, look at the situation and to help us, rather than just say, you're fine, it's all in your head.
Finally, Ashley says her husband shared with her the reason for his mental anguish, his guilt over a routine field mission to flush out insurgents that went horribly wrong.
He said that they ended up gunning down the entire family, the women, the children. And he said that nobody wanted to shoot. He said everybody was waiting for somebody else to start. And then when people started, he said he couldn't aim at them.
The couple sought counselling, but when the army told him he'd have to return to combat, his inner demons rose up in force. Walking into a nearby forest, Jared put a gun in his mouth and pulled the trigger.
I just remember thinking in my head that this was going to be it. This was what was going to do him in, and it did.
What scares me is that I don't think that our society is ready for all of our wounded. A lot of the guys that do have physical injuries also have PTS. There are dozens and dozens and dozens of soldiers that have lost all four limbs. There are dozens who have lost three limbs. There are hundreds who have lost two limbs, both legs. I see the newspapers occasionally still talk about the war, and when they do, they say America is at war, and that's not true. America's at the mall. Our military's at war, and they're not prepared for 40 or 50,000 wounded soldiers to descend on society in the next couple of years.
A sobering prospect, to say the least. And Australia is dealing with the same issues, albeit on a smaller scale. There's more background information about PTSD on our website. Nick first reported on this issue 5 years ago. His story was called Forgotten Soldiers. You can go online and see how much or little has changed since then. That's at sbs.com.au/dateline. Up next, the Gulf of Despair. On the second anniversary of the Deepwater Horizon oil disaster in the Gulf of Mexico, locals warned that the water's still toxic and that people are desperately ill.
Everything is bad in Mississippi and Louisiana and Alabama. Everything is bad. It's really bad. It's people dying.
And in Cairo's Tahrir Square, Christians and Muslims bonding through music.
الموسيقى انا شايف يعني زي ما قلت انه دايما الموسيقى دور مهمه جدا في كل ثوره وفي كل ثورات دايما في عالم تاريخ كل الثورات في كل البلاد